and welcome in. Thanks for joining us at New Roads Online today. I'm Kathy O'Leary, and I love being part of the New Roads community and serving on the staff team. As we get started today, we'd love to hear from you in the chat box. You can chat with us live at newroads.online.church during our 10 a.m. Sunday broadcast. Let us know where you're joining us from. Say hello to a friend watching in another location. Or let us know how you're experiencing God's presence as we worship together today. You can also let us know how we can pray for you today, either in the chat box or by clicking the Request Prayer button just below this video in Church Online. If you'd like to watch church on your TV, you can find us easily on YouTube and use another device to sign into the chat. As we get ready to worship, right now is the perfect time to extend an invitation to someone you know to join you for Church Online today. Who in your life could use some hope, peace, or inspiration these days? You can invite someone by text, email, or social media. Just send them the link, newroads.online.church. By the way, if you're kind of new here, either because someone invited you or you just came across us somehow, we'd love to meet you. Click on the link that says I'm new, either in Church Online or on our website. We'd love to connect with you and help you get better connected into our community. As we begin, we want to let you know that the Mass you'll see broadcast today has been pre-recorded from our newly renovated South Worship Space at St. Joseph. Our live stream of Mass will be coming soon, and we can't wait. For now, we're thrilled to be back in our South Worship Space for both online and in-person worship every Sunday at 10 a.m. Thanks again for being here today. Now it's time to worship together.
When all I see is the battle, you see my victory. A mountain, you see a mountain move. And as I walk through the shadow, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I am safe with you. So when I'll fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. For me, who can be against me? Yeah. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. Can't stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Amen. The grace and peace of God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Thanks for joining us from wherever you are as we come together to worship God in this season called Ordinary Time, in a world where life feels anything but ordinary. Recognizing our need for God's presence and guidance, let's quiet our minds and our hearts to allow space for God to meet us here and now. Lord Jesus, you came among us to show us the depth of God's love for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you revealed God's kingdom at the wedding feast at Cana. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord Jesus, you call us to recognize and demonstrate God's love. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Amen.
Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace to people of goodwill. Glory to God in the highest. Glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace to people of goodwill. We praise you, we bless you, we adore you, we glorify you. We give you thanks for your great glory, Lord God, Heavenly King. Oh God, Almighty Father, glory to God in the highest, glory to God in the highest, and on earth.
Let us pray. God of wonders, at Cana in Galilee, you revealed your glory in Jesus Christ and invited all humanity to life in him. Show your transforming power to your people gathered on this day. We make our prayer through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen. It's time to hear God's word to us today. We want children to hear God's word too, so we have videos online where kids get to hear God's word applied to their age and stage of life. Now is the perfect time to check them out. There are videos for preschoolers, elementary age kids, and preteens. You can set your kids up on another device to watch any of those videos right now at newroadscatholic.org/kids.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not be silent. For Jerusalem's sake, I will not be quiet, until her vindication shines forth like the dawn, and her victory like a burning torch. Nations shall behold your vindication, and all the kings your glory. You shall be called by a new name, pronounced by the mouth of the Lord. You shall be a glorious crown in the hand of the Lord, a royal diadem held by your God. No more shall people call you forsaken or your land desolate. You shall be called my delight and your land espoused. For the Lord delights in you and makes your land his spouse. As a young man marries a virgin, your builder shall marry you. And as a bridegroom rejoices in his bride, so shall your God rejoice in you. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
My soul is thirsting for you. My God, for you I long, for you my soul is thirsting, my body pines for you, like a dry, weary land without water.
My soul is thirsting for you, oh Lord my God. Thirsting for you, oh Lord my God, oh Lord my God, oh my soul.
So I gaze on you in the sanctuary to see your strength and your glory, for your love is better than life. My lips shall speak your praise.
My soul is thirsting for you, oh Lord my God, oh Lord my God, oh my soul is thirsting for you.
Have been my help. In the shadow of your wings, I rejoice. My soul clings to you. Your right hand holds me fast.
thirsting for you. Oh Lord, my God. Oh Lord, my God. Oh, my soul is thirsting for you. Oh Lord, my God. Oh Lord, my God. Oh, my soul.
A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, there are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit. There are different forms of service, but the same Lord. There are different workings, but the same God, who produces all of them in everyone. To each individual, the manifestation of the Spirit is given for some benefit. To one is given, through the Spirit, the expression of wisdom. To another, the expression of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. To another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another, mighty deeds. To another, prophecy. To another, discernment of spirits. To another, varieties of tongues. To another, interpretation of tongues. But one and the same Spirit produces all of these, distributing them individually to each person as he wishes. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
There was a wedding at Cana in Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples were also invited to the wedding. When the wine ran short, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, how does your concern affect me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servers, "Do whatever he tells you." Now there were 6 stone water jars there for Jewish ceremonial washings, each holding 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus told them, "Fill the jars with water." So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, "Draw some out now and take it to the head waiter." So they took it. And when the head waiter tasted the water that had become wine, without knowing where it had come from, although the servers who had drawn the water knew, the head waiter called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves good wine first, and when people have drunk freely, an inferior one. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this as the beginning of his signs at Cana in Galilee, and so revealed his glory, and his disciples began to believe in him. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Well, it's already the third week of our message series to kick off the new year, which we've been calling Difficult People. I'm glad you're here today as we continue this series. Having difficult people in our lives is nothing new, really. But it does seem like during the pandemic, many of our relationships have become particularly stressful and strained. Maybe you have a boss who is a micromanager or a coworker who complains constantly. Maybe you have someone in your life who just can't stop talking about politics, and whether you agree with them or not, it's exhausting and draining. Maybe your marriage isn't in such a good place. There's just this unspoken tension, all these little annoyances that have built up over time. Relationships, healthy or unhealthy, are a critical component of our lives. You could even say the quality of our lives is only as good as the quality of our relationships. And if you're human, I'll bet your relationships aren't all perfect. In fact, I'm pretty certain of that, because it's the number one thing people are looking for guidance and help about when I talk with them. Relationships, relationship problems, difficult people. No matter your profession, no matter your personality, dealing with difficult people is something we all have in common. Our approach in this series is to look to God's wisdom when it comes to our relationships. And we began by taking a little relational inventory. What's healthy? What's not? What relationship is God inviting me to focus on in this season? And then last week, we looked at how healthy relationships flow from a clear understanding of who we are and who we're not. And here's who we are: beloved children of God. No matter who you are or what you've done, God loves you totally and completely, no strings attached. And here's who you're not: perfect. No one is perfect. Which is another way of saying that to someone in some way, you are a difficult person. It's not always so easy to see that or admit that, though, because we spend so much time thinking about the people in our lives that we find difficult. We know their flaws and faults so well. It leaves hardly any room or time for self-examination. So that's what I encouraged you to do last week. This isn't about excusing anyone's behavior or saying your difficult person isn't a difficult person. I'm sure they are. It's just about getting grounded in reality. Yeah, I have difficult people in my life, and I can also be a difficult person. We're more able to look at our flaws honestly when we can do so in the presence of God, who knows us and loves us, flaws, mistakes, failures, and all. All of us difficult people are beloved children of God. This week, we're taking another step with this topic, and we're using today's gospel as a jumping-off point. The story we heard today, called The Wedding at Cana, might appear to be a straightforward miracle account. When we take it literally, it seems the focus is simply the wedding. But there's much more to the story, so we need to take a step back to consider what it's really trying to teach us. This story is found only in John's Gospel, which is known for its rich symbolism and layers of meaning. Take, for example, the setting, a wedding feast. Weddings are used in the Bible to symbolize the marriage of God and his people. The image of the wedding feast is a metaphor for how God desires to bring humanity together again from a place of brokenness. The setting of a wedding in the story is also an image of the kingdom of God, a feast, a celebration. Jesus has announced that the kingdom of God is at hand, and now he's about to show us what it's like, how it works. So let's look at this story a little more closely. There's a wedding, but the wedding runs into a problem. The wine runs out. Now that might seem like not a big deal, but in the cultural context of that time and place, hospitality was a huge deal, the biggest deal. To run out of wine at a wedding feast was unimaginable, as it would bring dishonor to the families hosting this major community-wide event, and even call into question the joining of the two families. Wedding feasts are meant to last for days. A lack of wine would end the celebration quickly, resulting in considerable embarrassment for the couple and the families hosting. So Jesus, at the request of his mother, does something about it. It's easy to see this as a simple, quick fix miracle. There's no wine? Boom, more wine. But that's really not what happens. And that's really not how God works, even in miracles. There's always more God is doing through a miracle than just the miracle itself, than what appears at the surface. Jesus didn't simply snap his fingers and make more wine appear. He involves the servants. They participate in what God is doing. They get to be part of the miracle. And through their witness, we get to see how astounding, unexpected, and extravagant is God's action. Jesus doesn't just make some extra wine appear. It's an overabundance, more than they could ever consume in a month or a year. And it's the best quality wine anyone has ever tasted. Jesus does something way beyond providing a quick fix to a simple problem. When it comes to our difficult people and difficult relationships, I think we'd really like it if God would just snap his fingers and fix that person who's driving us absolutely crazy. But he doesn't. Why not? I think God has something richer and better in mind than a quick fix to our relationship problems. Look at how it happens in today's story. Mary tells Jesus there's no wine, and she then tells the servants, do whatever he tells you. I can imagine the servers saying, sure, lady, listen, we have a real problem here and we have to fix it. What could he possibly do about it? Let's be practical. They have no idea. But Mary does. She knows who Jesus is. Her simple words, do whatever he tells you, have an application way beyond the context of this story. They apply, really, to the whole of life. Do whatever Jesus tells you. So what does it mean to do whatever Jesus tells you when it comes to dealing with difficult people? Well, Jesus is pretty specific about how to deal with difficult people. He spoke about it several times in the Gospels, but here's just one example. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your heavenly Father. For he makes his sun rise on the bad and the good, and causes rain to fall on the just and the unjust. Jesus says, when it comes to difficult people, here's what to do. Love them. And you're thinking, no thanks, Jesus. I'd like to fix them. We want our difficult people to change. But if we're honest, we know we're powerless to change them. Maybe you've tried and you've realized you can't change them and you have no control over them. That's the bad news. The good news is you can control how you respond to them. You can choose how you behave in the relationship. You can choose how you view difficult people, as an annoyance or as an opportunity. An opportunity to grow in love, to grow in character. Because how you deal with difficult people reveals your character. And it's precisely in those difficult relationships where we have the greatest opportunity to build our character and to grow in love. As impossible as it may seem, or as difficult as it may be to do. How exactly do you do that, if you want to do that? Well, three suggestions for your consideration. And for each of these, notice how uncomfortable these suggestions are. Notice how hard these actually are to put into practice. That means you're on the right track, and it's an indication that you've got room to grow in character. These are huge opportunities for you. Suggestion number one, try praying for them. Not praying that they get a flat tire or lose their job or get COVID. Pray sincerely for their well-being and success. Pray for God's blessing in their lives. Pray for their family. Pray for their joy. Suggestion number two, try serving them in some small way this week. Do something kind for them. Do them a small favor or kindness. They might reject it or miss it, or who knows. It's not about that. It's about you doing something for them, loving that person you find it difficult to love, putting a stake in the ground to say, I'm not really like this, God. But you are. Help me to be more like you. Suggestion number three. Instead of gossiping or venting, try saying something positive about that person to someone else who maybe knows both of you. Now, I'm not suggesting that you do all of these things. Just try one and notice how hard it is and rejoice in that. And that being hard, because it means you're growing. You're on the right track. Do you remember those Staples ads with the big red easy button? Press it and your office supply problem is solved. We want an easy button for our difficult people. Press it and proof, a difficult person becomes easy. How awesome would that be? I think God has a better vision in mind for us, though. A better vision of you. A better vision of me. An opportunity for us to become like God. To become love. Loving difficult people isn't easy, but it's worth it. That's the miracle we're invited to be a part of. Not changing someone else, but allowing God to change our hearts. Let's profess our faith together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body,
and life everlasting. Amen.
Let's offer our prayers for ourselves, our community, and our world.
For the Church and for New Roads Catholic Community, that those who follow Jesus together may be transformed and bring healing to our world. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For healing of the divisions within the human family, that racism, sexism, oppression, prejudice, and all violence cease. May each person be treated with dignity, respect, and welcome. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the grace of discernment, that we may understand the signs of the times and recognize God's presence, action, and invitation to respond each day. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who work for social, racial, and economic justice in our society, that their faithful witness to the good news that all people are daughters and sons of God may persuade and motivate others to join their quest. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are facing crisis, loss, or grief, for the poor, the sick, the lonely, and the lost, that the Spirit of God will guide us to comfort them and help them to face the future. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who have died, may they experience the fullness of joy and peace in heaven. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
God of mercy and unconditional love, our world often seems to be falling apart. You invite us to respond in love and forgiveness, kindness and generosity. Empower us to use the gifts you give us for the good of the world. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. We pause now to remember how much God has given each of us and to give some of that back to God and His Church. Your giving makes our ministry at New Roads possible. We rely completely on your support and are deeply grateful for your generosity to further our mission. If you'd like to give to New Roads today, just text New Roads, all one word, to the number 202-858-1233. When you text us, you'll get a link sent back to give online via credit card, Venmo, or any online platform you prefer. Thank you for your support of this community.
I won't forget the wonder of how you brought deliverance, the exodus of my heart. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters from my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory. Hallelujah, hallelujah. You have taught. Day is the sign that you are with me. The fire by night is the guiding light to my feet. You found me, you freed me, held back the waters for my release. Oh, Yahweh, you're the God who fights for me, Lord of every victory.
Our gifts are prepared, so I invite you to pray, sisters and brothers, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and honor of God's name, for our good and the good of all His holy church.
Grant us, O Lord, we pray, that we may participate worthily in these mysteries. For whenever the memorial of this sacrifice is celebrated, the work of our redemption is accomplished. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live and move and have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care for us, but even now possess the pledge of eternal life. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the Paschal mystery. And so, with all the angels, we praise you, as in joyful celebration we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending your Spirit upon them, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it. For this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for the many for forgiveness of sin. Do this in memory of me." The Mystery of Faith.
When we eat this bread,
therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, Sean, our bishop, and all your holy people. Remember also our sisters and brothers who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with Saint Luke, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
Amen.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your friends, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let's offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Amen. Amen. upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you.
Let us pray. God of mercy, pour forth upon us the spirit of your love, that we who have worshiped together may be one in mind and heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord and one another.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you for worshiping at New Roads today. We're grateful for your presence. Have a great Martin Luther King Day and a great week.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family and your children and their children and their children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations and your family, and your children, and their children, and their children.
May his favor be upon you, and upon you.